Isaiah 53:5. And I want to make sure that you get the right kind of understanding for this particular verse. For it says that he was pierced through for our transgressions, for he was crushed for our iniquities. The chastisement of our well-being is upon him, and by his scourging, or his stripes, we are healed. That's why we go to Christ. Now, I'm not going to get into the charismatic argument that you can have all physical healings, because you're not. I was telling the brother earlier, I have tremendous arthritic pain in my right hand. Yesterday I had tremendous heart problems because I have coronary heart disease. I can't speak that away. That's from years of eating the wrong kind of food and not exercising properly as an older man. I have that. Your dad died of something. Everybody, everybody's going to die of something. And so this doesn't mean that because Christ came that I'm going to be healed of this. If you're looking for healing, you better go somewhere else, because you're going to die one day. You are going to die. All of us are going to die. Thing is, we don't know how or where or when. I'm thinking about not some of these so-called, who is it? Walter Cronkite, 91, right? It's a long life, man.
Long life.
Long life. I don't even want to live that long. That's a little bit too long to be on this planet. But you know what? Some people are going to be living that long, and some people, teenager will get a disease at 12 years old and die tomorrow. You don't know how long you're going to be here. But Christ made it possible. This verse fulfilled with the language of substitution. That's all that means. Christ became our substitute. The servant suffered not for his own sin, but he suffered for our sins. The emphasis on this Isaiah text is placed here on Christ being the substitute recipient of God's wrath for sinners. That's why I follow Christ. Not your pastor, not your church ministry. Christ is. That's why when you look at the full panoramic view of the portrait that he wants you to paint of him, we follow him because of his goodness to us. Point. Well, I see me in the portrait. Mark chapter 2, verse 17. Yes. But I put down, do you see you in the portrait? In 2:17, I think I see me. In Mark chapter 2, verse 17, it says, And hearing this, Jesus said to them, it is not those who are healthy who need a physician, but those who are sick. I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners. See what Christ came to do? Christ came to call sinners. He didn't come to call righteous people. I don't even view myself as a righteous person. I view myself as a sinner that is saved by God's grace. But I'm going to tell you, at least sometime today, I'm going to fail God. And I'm going to fail him miserably. That's why it's important for us to pray every night and ask God to forgive us of how we live. Let's move on down to the next point of this outline. I see Christ as the liberator. Point number 3, as we go back to our Luke 4 text, for it says, as the liberator to proclaim release to the captives. To proclaim release to the captives. Jesus knows that every person on this planet is chained by the Adamic nature. Everybody knows what the Adamic nature means, right? The nature of Adam, the first man. We are all enslaved to that. That is why we don't have to worry about how we sin. Okay, he also knew that there's only one person who can release all of these people from that sin. And that one person is Christ. That's why when you go out this week and you're living before people and they say, oh, so you're a Christian, and you say yes. And then they ask you the question, well, so I need to be saved? Don't answer that right up front. You say, man, I don't know what you mean. All I know is that I've discovered for myself, since I was a lost sinner, that now I have freedom and a greater responsibility in Christ. I want you to picture in your mind being freed from the most horrible of sins. Don't tell me, don't tell your neighbor, what is the most horrible of sins that God has released you from? I'm not even going to tell you what he released me from, because you'd all get up and run. And I'm sure I'd be running when you told me about yours. Well, see, I used to, what? Yes, we'd all be running in different directions. See, because Christ has released us from that. You want to picture that in your mind, and all you would say is, what a scene. What a scene. I'm glad I didn't die like that. See, and that's why when you ask somebody like McNair and Jackson, they didn't have time to repent of any sins. The last scene that they saw is the scene where they were before they got tapped.
Yep.
And then, whammo. Another world, another case, another story. He liberated me. That's what we would say. And I realized that I have need to be freed from my sin. He has also liberated others. And he has been doing that for centuries. He wants to liberate the people in our community. He wants to liberate our politicians. He wants to liberate Obama. Man, it's arrogance. Well, I don't want to talk about him because he doesn't even matter in my. But he wants to deliver him. Brilliant, brilliant. Brilliant mind. Brilliant. But he needs to be liberated. And you know when you see it? When he signs a petition that not another child will be aborted in this country. If so, you will be penalized. And you will go to jail for doing that. But he's not going to say that.
No.
Because he has not been liberated. I don't care what anybody says. Okay. And he wants to liberate you. Look at Luke 19 and 10. I don't know whether you ever looked at this in Luke 19. Oh, it was beautiful. There's so many beautiful scriptures in the Bible. It says, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. He didn't come here. Now, if it says the Son of Man came to give you prosperity, no, he didn't. No, he didn't. He only came here to do one thing, to seek and to save that which was lost. Since everybody is lost, he came to seek and to save everybody. It's not for you to find out who that body is. It's for you to be ready when God has you ready to speak to that body. How can you speak to that body if you're living like a person that's still lost? It makes no sense at all. But that's why the Son of Man came. Look at Matthew 18, 12 through 14. I know it's kind of warm, but hang in there with me. Matthew 18, 12 through 14. Here Jesus talks about this himself, and these are beautiful, beautiful words right here, because he gives kind of like a classification of why he came, and what you want to do is keep this portrait clear in your mind. What do you think? If any man has 100 sheep and one is going astray, does he not leave the 99 on the mountains and go and search for the one who is straying? That means Christ wants to use us to get other people saved. And then he says, and if it turns out that he finds it, truly I say to you, he rejoices over it more than over 99 which have not gone astray. And then he says, thus it is not the will of the Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. That's why I truly believe that if God gives me the opportunity, it's like, you know, when I get in that classroom, I was telling one of my friends last semester at Harvard College, every morning I'm at the college an hour before my class begins. Why? Because I'm out in green pastures.
Beside the still waters, he restoreth my soul and guides my path in righteousness for.